No pressure.
Although many artists aspire to be funny, few truly are. And even fewer can move between issues of humor and gravity seamlessly. Martin Carcells can. He's been making works of music, sculpture, video, and performance for the past 15 years. Carcells' practice is broad and ballsy, from aggressively honest works that confront the body to carefully formulated conceptual works that further the dialogue of sculpture and object making. From Tossing a Friend, 1996, where Carcells hurled a friend named Melinda in three still frames, to Pink Constellation, 2001, an all-pink girl's bedroom rotating in tandem with a camera lens, creating a magical effect of the performers walking on the walls, dancing on the ceiling, and tumbling within the space. To a more recent project, Charms in a Throne Room, from 2006, that offered a series of discrete sculptures dangling from the ceiling like illuminated shamanic objects. Carcells is funny and fearless, with a practice that spans from the performative use of live music, physical comedy, and dance, to careful consideration of the sculptural object as surrogate, symbol, and usable structure. Carcells received his BFA in 1984 from UCLA, and then 10 years later returned to UCLA to receive his MFA in 1995. He's exhibited extensively, both nationally and internationally, taking part in such seminal group exhibitions as California Video at the Getty Center, Dionysic at the Pompidou Center in Paris, and Young Americans 2 at the Saatchi Gallery in London. He's had solo exhibitions at Acme Gallery here in Los Angeles, Deitch Projects in New York, and Modern Art in London. This past fall, Carcells had a survey exhibition of his work titled Martin Carcells, Poland Heavyweight Champion, at the Santa Monica Museum of Art. We're really lucky to have Martin here. He is someone who is here in Los Angeles, but does not always come around and talk. It's awesome to have you. It's awesome for me to meet you. And I'm super excited, and I know this will be fun. So join me in welcoming Martin.
That's a very nice introduction. I'm almost...
Well, I love you.
I'm kind of embarrassed right now. My son, who's 14, thought I should razz USC for losing in the NCAA tournament. I said, you know, usually when you go to a grad school and talk about art, they're usually, what, we have a basketball team? I'm like, what? Like, so then he said, well, you should tell a USC joke. So I have a USC joke. Why did the USC students feel so good about finishing the jigsaw puzzle in 2.5 years? Because the box said 3 to 5. So, you probably don't get many USC. I mean, art school's always kind of off the chart. Like, they're their own island, right? Like, when Paul McCarthy was here at grad school, I think you were in a building, the art program was in a building across the freeway in an old, maybe, department store or something. I mean, it was in some sort of converted building, and so all the stuff, it sort of was like the hinterlands. And so here, you're kind of your own island, right? You have a tram, but you kind of do your own thing, right? Mm-hmm. No?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Your own world. And though some of you do go to teach, right? And was it Rye, when you were here, you said you were teaching football players ceramics?
Yeah.
And you enjoyed that very much. But they would do busts of themselves.
Bags of clay.
Bags of, like 300 pound sculptures of themselves that then would inevitably blow up in the kitchen because they didn't really give a shit like how it was. But, does anyone have any athletes in their classes right now?
Yeah.
Pray tell.
I'm a track star.
Is that really a sport?
Yeah, she's
awesome.
On scholarship.
She's on scholarship. Anyone else?
We have a track player who doesn't show up very much, and he, for a project on systems, networks, he made outside of class, and then he brought in two battle axes and a shield, like welded, the Tommy Trojan emblem on it. This is like an advanced sculpture. And then he starts his crit, and he's presenting, and then he goes, but really, I should really do this. And then he rips his shirt off. And it's like a physique of the god. And he made that sound.
See, how did I know? How did I know? Anyone else have? I like the student athlete scholar. So, my practice began in the 80s with performance. And I was coming out of an undergraduate program at UCLA that really didn't have, per se, a performance program, and people actually didn't really do that much performance. So my last year there, Mike Kelly had just graduated from CalArts, and so I got to take classes with him, which was pretty amazing, because he actually, because of the CalArts tradition, he actually kept office hours, and none of the other faculty did. You go and talk to him, he talked to you kind of like a young artist rather than just someone who was a problem to them. And so, but most of the performance, I didn't learn things about so much about performance in school. I learned working with a group called Shrimps, which started out as a collaborative group, starting out as large men doing diminutive movement. So there's these guys, and we always use platforms as these kind of defining spaces that we performed on. They're both resonators and space closers, so to speak, like to close in the space. But it would be like movements like these little hand gestures, little wiggles with the butt, you know, and like slow little movements forward, and always kind of approaching the audience, like kind of getting close. No reaction. And it was really a good experience for a young artist to work in a collaborative, because it had this a situation where I felt I could put forward ideas, but also have them shot down, so to speak, if they were bad, or at least like thought of as bad. So I was able to do things with the group that I feel like I couldn't have done by myself. There was power in the group. I also learned a lot about timing and how to interact with an audience, how to work with space, sight lines, and things like that. Shrimps wasn't kind of was theatrical in that you go 8 o'clock, go see Shrimps at Lace or at what is it? PS 122 or Intermediate Arts in Minneapolis. We traveled around to different places. But it wasn't theatrical in its kind of structure. It was movement-based. There was a lot of, at that point, performance in the 80s had this, was sort of like growing and mixing with experimental theater. People like George Coates and Tim Miller were playing with monologue and Robert Wilson, and working with kind of grander theater. And we were kind of like the C-plus students. We weren't the A students that did the big work. We always did work that was like 12 to 15 minutes long, made a mess, and then we kind of left. Or we'd do four of those pieces in an evening, and then we'd be gone. And so this is one of the last pieces I was sort of involved in. Let's see, when is this? 93, I think. So I started in 84, this is about 93, called Looks. And it was the longest piece we had done, because it was for this performance festival in New York that was at Lincoln Center. And so it was sort of like this culmination. And in 92, I went back to graduate school, and I stopped doing Shrimps in 93. As a little side note, we got together in 05 and created a new piece that we performed at Lace, which was sort of interesting because it sort of mimics this whole later interest of mine in rock bands and how they have their moment and then they try to kind of recapture it, rekindle it sometime later when it's sort of maybe inappropriate. So in 92, I go back to school at UCLA. It was a sweet deal, maybe not as sweet as some of your deals, but as students, but I worked there as a lab assistant to Paul McCarthy and Chris Burden in the New Genres area. That's Rye, I think you met me there, didn't you?
Oh, I just missed you.
You just missed me?
Yeah.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I was at Cal Arts already, right. Yeah. Right. So I was at UCLA and running the New Genres area, teaching kids how to edit and checking out equipment and whatnot. And I decided to go to school, and it was really great because for like $128 a semester, like I could go to school, or a quarter there, I could go to school and get a studio. And so I started making, but the one proviso that Chris and Paul made on me, because I applied in the New Genres area, was that they didn't want me doing Shrimp's work as my work. And so there was, I wasn't planning on it, but there was a definitive moment where it was like, you can't do this, you have to do something else. And I still didn't want to do sort of solo performance, I wanted to make objects. And so what I understood the best, or what I feel like I understood the best, and I don't know if I still do understand it totally, is the idea of something, objects within creating a performance, or a moment that one can think about as performance, or something that is enacted by the audience in some way, or it reacts to the audience. So this, I wouldn't say it's just sort of interactive work, because sometimes they have their own agency. The pieces have their own agency. It's not always about the audience making something happen. Sometimes it performs for them. So something that was coined, I don't know by who, but the idea of the performative object. And this is one of the first ones I made, and it's a piece called Twist. And just as another side note, I'm going to probably not show you all my slides because there's just too many of them for the time, so I'll talk about some and then skip through others. And I want questions too. If people do have questions, by all means, interrupt, ask, make comments. So the Twist is a 9 foot long rubber band chain made of like say 12,000 rubber bands, kind of knotted together into this kind of muscle that I wanted to make, and at the top. And I knew that this was the center of the piece when I wanted to make it. It was sort of like I wanted something that had tension and had referenced the body, like the muscle, and also had strength. And then I figured out I needed to sort of animate it in some way. But I didn't want it to be animated in a predictable way. I wanted the work to be unpredictable to a certain degree. And so at the top of this is the motor unit, probably way overbuilt for what I did, but at the time I hadn't really made things like this before. But it's a motor, and it has a switching system that for 2 minutes it spins in one direction, it stops for a minute, and then it goes 2 minutes in the other direction. So there's this tightening, and there's this loosening, and there's this place of stasis also. Once I had all this made, the decision was, what do I have at the end of this? What do I make? What completes this system? And I thought about it, many different things. furniture, something I would carve, books, whatever. I had gone to a thrift store. I used to live in Pico Union. You guys know where that is?
Yeah.
Like Hoover and Venice. That area. That's where I used to live. And my wife and I went over there to, I think, look for flatware for the table or something like that. And so we're looking and, you know, looking at the books and records, and because this is like 93, tchotchkes, and then there's this prosthetic leg sitting on the shelf. The prosthetic leg is like $5. like with shoe and sock. Like totally good. Like, I think, well, I don't know, like, where can you, like, $5 for that? And I think, well, I can maybe use it for something, or, like, I thought of Tim Hawkinson, who lived downtown at the time, like, maybe, you know, I'd give it to him, you know, he could use it, because he would come to my garage, which was this weird garage that was actually leftover junk from the previous people, and he would, like, take some stuff, and it wound up as, you know, his work. So I thought, okay, we can continue that process. He would make me dinner, I'd bring him a prosthetic leg or something. So I'm walking, we buy it, and walking across the park, and it's Pico Union, so it's like, it's, you know, like a lot of Latino guys, it's like Salvadoran, Nicaraguan, like sitting out during the day enjoying, you know, like some kids playing, some gambling, a lot of different things going on. And all of a sudden, like, you know, it's carrying in the bag and the top is sticking out. And all of a sudden I hear, hey, hey! And I look over and there's this guy lying on a mattress waving the stump of his leg in the air. And I go, like, is this guy's leg? Like, did his buddies, like, as a joke, put it in the Goodwill box? You know, like, steal it one night when he was asleep and put it in the Goodwill box, and now he sees his leg and he's, like, trying to track me. Like, and I think, oh my gosh, should I go and see him? And Mike goes, no, I think we should go home. But then I take a couple of steps and I go, I have three legs, he has one. There's an equity. So I go back and I hand him the bag, and he takes the leg out and he puts it on and he goes, oh, it's too big. And he hands it back to me. Right? It's too big. And then he points up to the canopy of trees and I see his leg about 20 feet in the air. But his leg has a broken ankle. His prosthetic leg has a broken ankle, which I thought was. So here comes this point, and I don't know. I don't really know how to always say this, but so I'll say it and you can. Hopefully, it's clear enough. Is that, like, the way I tend to work is I tend to have an idea of something I want to explore. I want to bring some question about, usually it's about mortality a lot of times, or it's about failure, or it's about some sort of sense of, I don't know, humanness, humanism to the surface in the work. And I work, but that could be working through different modes of research culturally. But there comes a point for me where I have to take a leap, and I have to take a jump. And sometimes that jump is more educated and more well thought, and other times it's just sort of like, well, let's just try this, right? Let's just take this step and see how it goes. Let's see if it flies. And that was with the leg ones. I thought, well, all this happened, the guy thought it was his leg, and I was kind of sad when he was going to take it. I thought it was his leg too, but he didn't, and so I felt like, okay, it was given back to me. The leg was given back to me. And I thought I could use it on this piece. And what was holding me back, or was at the time, was Hans Bellmer. Now, Hans Bellmer, I always felt his work was really totally creepy. And did anyone agree? Do people like Hans Bellmer? Kind of, because it's creepy, right? But it really, it was like, it just creeped me out a little too much that I think I didn't even want my piece to be in the same breath of Hans Bellmer. Not that I feel that's like a bad thing, it's just not, that's not what I want, right? You like Hans Bellmer, right?
Sure.
You wouldn't mind being in the same breath as Leila Dare and Hans Bellmer. If they did a two-person show, right, it'd be okay. So, but then when I started testing this, can I borrow your shoe, Michael?
Sure.
Right or left? What's that?
Right or left.
Doesn't matter. Okay. It's a nice shoe, isn't it? Look at those soles. Those are trippy.
It's like a bear.
It's like the German Vans. You know that the Puma and the Adidas guy were brothers?
Yeah,
and they dislike each other now. They're bitter competitors. Even though their factories are like really close to
the Whistler brothers.
Oh, so see. So, what was the point of the shoe? When I started testing this, and what happens is that the 2 minutes of winding up tightens this and just creates a lot of tension. And this leg acts as it gets caught up against the wall. You see this dirty part here. It actually kicks the wall, and it kicks a hole in the wall eventually. But it gets all tightened up and bound up until there's so much energy in this that it then all of a sudden released, and this leg goes wildly gesticulating and kicking and doing all sorts of things. And then that 1 minute when it stops, and it just stops, and it's in this kind of state of suspension because it's being held up by the rubber bands, and it just sort of stays there to be admired and to look at in its tense moment. And then it unwinds and relaxes, only to then start the cycle again. But what saved this from Belmerville for me was that as sometimes it would do, it would start to pirouette. The foot started pirouetting, right? And started going like this faster than I could do now. And with the loafer and the white sock, it was Michael Jackson. The piece became Michael Jackson. And that wasn't anywhere in the plan. But that moment, that realization for me of pulling it out of from prosthetic to kind of pointing to a cultural icon who at the time was at a height of his popularity, we didn't know about all his other things that he did. We didn't know about Neverland yet. That I thought made the piece work for me. And that's it. Slideshow's over. I just talk about one piece and then it's over.
Belmer to Michael Jackson. Yeah.
Well, isn't it? But that's this kind of like breadth that I would like in a good piece. I'd like to be able to have those kind of references. It does, and of course it doesn't always work that way, you know, because I think I got lucky.
Was that shown at Dan Bernier?
That was shown at Dan Bernier. And it's sort of as a work, it's the work that's been shown the most. Like, it's been shown in all these group shows and, you know, all over the place, and now the museum owns it, and they put it up periodically because it's a crowd favorite. It's very funny. Now, can I tell another little story about it? The guy who bought it sold it to Saatchi, and Saatchi, they were worried about the shoe wearing out, rightfully so. So they bought, when I came to see it, they had bought all these different loafers. They had like 20 different pairs of loafers that they wanted my approval on which one was the right one, and I said none of them. Because they didn't look right. They all looked weird and clunky. It wasn't the Michael Jackson look. In the practice too, I like to have these kind of experiments. And this one's called Attempt to Raise the Temperature of a Container of Water by Yelling at It. And it involves an audio, the idea being, here's a speaker, underwater speaker, and here's a thermometer probe and a recording thermometer that shows the temperature. And now it's a CD player, but it was a tape player at one point. So out of the amplifier into the water is my voice trying to get the water to vibrate enough and to react to my voice in order to create heat. The idea being molecules, like the microwave works by bombarding the object, creating molecules to vibrate, and as you vibrate, create heat. And so the idea of my anger, so anger being this method to try to heat water. So what the tape is a 7-minute loop of, do you mind if I yell?
Go for it.
Because I really can yell. I have approval, kind of sign off on it.
You can yell.
Okay. It starts with, I'm trying to raise the temperature of this water by yelling at it. I am trying to raise the temperature of this water by yelling at it. And that goes on until minute 7 or so, when it's, I am trying to raise the temperature of this water by yelling at it! And all the while there's a little needle dropping on some Portis head. So it's just like, doo doo doo. 3 notes of Portis head. Doo doo doo. Doo doo doo. I am trying to raise the temperature! Doo doo doo. And as an experiment, I was interested in its success and failure. I thought if it succeeded, I have this really this way to raise temperature of water that takes a shitload of time. If I fail, then I'm kind of like showing about this kind of discussion about the failure of anger over inanimate objects. So I think it was sort of like success or failure was win-win, because it isn't really an experiment, it's an artwork, right? Which is a whole different area, I think. Any questions so far?
So that was a recording?
It was a recording, yeah. So it was a 7-minute loop.
Did the temperature rise?
It did. For the first time I did it, it went up 1 degree when I was testing it. And then another time when it was shown, it went up 1 degree. But then everyone goes, well, it's just the ambient temperature of the room and blah, 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 blah. So I don't know. But there comes a point when I'm like, it's like, okay, I'm the goldfish and I've circled the ball, right? Like, I'm onto something new. I'm actually sort of joking. The film work, I've also incorporated films into the practice. In this case, this is a piece called Precious Dancer. These are all from the 90s. It's a 24-minute sound film that's projected just this big or so on the wall of myself dancing. It's the most direct relational piece that relates most to shrimps, and it's that history of doing sinuous, sexy dancing for the camera for you. The idea is that I make this little film, show it close to the ground, show it so it's only kind of one viewer can kind of look at it, as this way, kind of like a Persian miniature or something like that. This is very specific dance for you. A variation is a swing film with fall, where it's rear projected on a coffee can lid. It wasn't important that it was a coffee can lid, but it worked the best. That's what the best device for working. This extension of the light, right? The light is coming at the lid, and I'm swinging back. I use the main bay at the graduate building at UCLA, which was big vaulted kind of barrel ceiling, and I would swing way back out into the darkness and then swing back out into the light. What I didn't think about, and again, this is about happenstance, is that as I was swinging, I thought it was gonna be 12 minutes because the camera had these 12-minute magazines. And after about 3 minutes, I was swinging forward and the rope broke. Not thinking, well, Martin, you're a big buffoon, maybe you know the abrasion. So as I swing down, all of a sudden, I fall out of frame. And I realized later that I make a cartoon character of myself, because what happens is just this hand is up, the only thing in the frame, and then it just sort of slides out. And it's just sort of like Wile E. Coyote, you know, like when he holds a stick of dynamite, he's gonna throw it and it blows up, he stands there, and then he just sort of crumbles. But I turned myself into a cartoon character at that point. So, which is interesting, because people ask, well, why do you use yourself? Why? I feel like I am, well, I think I'm a handsome man, and that's why I use myself. I talked to Joan Jonas about that, and she had said when she was starting her career as an artist, filmmaker, that she used herself in her films because she understood what she wanted wanted to be seen on the film, but she couldn't communicate it necessarily verbally to others. And it took a while for her to incorporate other people, and then even longer than to pull herself out. And I feel that's sort of why I started using myself, because I kind of understood how I could react or what I needed to do in order to get across the idea. And that I wasn't like the director that I couldn't direct in that way to be for someone to do what I needed them to do, at least at that point. Oops. These are photos. Charlie talked about the tossing photos, but it started with falling photos, and it started again with myself. And these are falling photos 7, 8, and 9. So there was 1 through 6 before that. And these are private performances, like in public or semi-public places. The falling photos tended to be in places that were kind of away from viewers and only the occasional person. This happens to be in Madison, Wisconsin. Not to Michael McHulty.
Very picturesque.
Yes, it was on the near the canal between the two lakes, and near the skating rink where they have the good hot chocolate. Do you remember that?
No.
Anyway, so these falling photos were kind of about putting myself into space, and then having the impact, and not necessarily, it wasn't important to show the after effects, what you could see here. I just sort of went up and down the bank of the ice pond, and you just sort of see these divots, which those then kind of morphed into tripping photos. Tripping, which is not falling, is different than tripping, in that tripping is kind of hints at the accident or something like that. And also, I think of maybe a little bit of shame in the idea that the thing that we feel we have the most control over, our bodies, we don't. We lose it, we trip over our shoelaces, we trip over ourselves, and we've lost control. And so that there's this kind of great embarrassment. So these were trying to be in more public places. This is near the Beverly Center. And I would just walk along and put 1 foot behind, the tip of my foot behind the heel of my other, and just go. And so I did that in like three or four different locations. Then to tossing. This is called Tossing a Friend. This is Patty, and I chose 6 friends and had a day-long shooting event of tossing people. Ryan, Melinda, 3 or 1, I don't remember. Oh, I missed her. So I tossed 6 friends, and that was kind of about making myself into a ride, like a carnival ride. In a way, what's something that I can do that maybe a lot of people can't? Well, I can throw my friends. and it was important that it was tossing a friend. These Melindas, the 1, 2, 3, there are 3 of them, were in this show called Situation Comedy, and I was looking at the essay about that. And then the essay said something pointed out about the misogyny of these photos. So here I was, tossing or manhandling this woman in this really negative way. And I said, they missed the point. Like, they wanted those photos to prove that point somehow. When in reality, I thought the photos were about trust and about a certain joy. Melinda doesn't look unhappy in these photos. It's not, she's being let loose of the bounds of gravity, at least momentarily, in a safe way, because I do toss them onto a mat, which you don't see, like a high jump pit. So what I looked at as like trust, they were looking at as misogyny. Sort of interesting. Whirling Mara, these are, there's a few of these, Whirling Melinda. These were self-portraits that I grabbed my, again, friends, I think it was five people this time, and whirled them by their feet or legs, and they took a portrait of me. So that I became the self-portrait, I became the, literally the center of this universe, right? It's the spinning mode of, like, I am just the center. Like, it's everything is spinning around me in this case. Mr. Keaty. And Patty. So they, I actually had bought one of those, a photographer's vest, like, you know, with all the pockets and stuff. And then tied the camera, like, to some of the hooks and stuff, so that if, in case they let go, it wouldn't, like, fly off. Like, so, or they wouldn't get hit in the face with the camera. Because you have to go fairly fast to get someone up, right? And then, this is from 2000. This is a Kuros and Me. And there's one, there's four of these. This is their two pairs. And this is a project done for the J. Paul Getty Museum. And the museum was trying to, this is under John Walsh, and the idea was that they wanted to incorporate contemporary art into the program somehow. And so they worked, hired Lisa Lyons, who used to run the Lannan Foundation here in Los Angeles, to curate, I think with John a little bit, a show of artists who would make projects for it. So John Baldessari and Judy Fiskin and Ruben Ortiz Torres and John M. Miller, the painter. Let's see, I forget who else was
in
that. What's that?
Stephen Prina.
Steve Prina, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so we all have kind of access, carte blanche access to the Getty to do whatever, to make a, something about the Getty itself as a museum, about a work in the collection. I chose something that wasn't even in the, wasn't even on display, but that I remembered going back 20 years before that was when the Getty bought the Kuros, and that it was always a, it was in contention whether it was an authentic 450 BC Kuros and they, or if it was a later forgery. And that had been going on for years, this argument between the art historians and the quote scientists or the conservators on it. And so that the Getty was in the midst of redoing Malibu, so they didn't have it up, it was just in storage. And I thought it was always interesting because that was something that I thought about, this museum, which had, you know, which museum has this responsibility to make, like, or to reflect history. I don't know, is it make history? I don't know exactly how to say it, but to partake in that discourse. And here there was, but that was always just a sidelight compared to the argument about authenticity. And if so, and if it was authentic, then they got a good deal, or they stole it really well. Or if it was inauthentic, then they got ripped off. So the museum, either as this very wise institution, or as this institution that gets caught up in this, plundering of history to bring this object. So they were very good about this, and they allowed me access to the Getty, I mean to the Kuros to see it. I mean, it was in this really cool crate that it's lying on its back, and then it has this motorized base that goes and then they gave me all sorts of measurements and this whole book of photographs of the Kuros, and I hired two sculptors to make it out of foam. So the Kuros weighs about 900 pounds, and my Kuros weighs about 45 pounds. and it's made of a carving foam. And so the idea was to put this into play, because also the Kouros is I think there's one other pair. The Kouros is a funerary sculpture that's supposed to embody kind of the best part of, like, it's supposed to be the ideal of the person who has died. So it's supposed to be the ideal male figure. So I, working with my ideal male figure and the Kouros, put it into play and made these large, they're about this size. The prints were actually about this size. So they're very large. And then I actually got to, in my part of the space for the show, I got to actually have the Kouros on display looking at the photographs.
The real one or the?
The real one. What was really interesting about they would say, if you're going to have the real, you know, we're going to set it up, but we're only going to set it up once. We're not going to set it up and move it over 2 feet or 5 inches. Once you set it up, it's set up. So I brought my Kouros with me, like to the Getty, and carrying it across the campus on my shoulder, like through the Getty, like up into the gallery, and putting it down. You know, this is where it's going to be. We mark out the space and everything, and then I take my Kouros away. So it's like, okay, my Kouros. Another time I did a performance at the Getty for Glenn Phillips, that performance symposium, and I show up at the, and my piece is with, well, I'll show you a little clip of it, but it involves an axe, and so I show up at the security desk with an axe. Or a hatchet. And I said, well, I'm here for the performance thing. And I have the hatchet with me, and they just point over, like, okay, go to that hallway. It was like the weirdest thing. Like, you think, like, they don't want gum, they don't want, like, you know, one piece of chiclet or something like that, but they'll let an axe into security. That's the guy whose show is up right now, right?
Yeah, it's Lee, yeah.
It sounds
just
like,
blitz,
yeah. It sounds sort of scary.
Yeah, it's a scary dude.
This is a, let's see, how much, what time do we have till? I just want to.
You're good. We have till 2, and it's like 10 to 1.
Okay, so I want to show a 12-minute videotape also. This is, I'm an interesting, maybe this is the first piece that sort of reflects an interest in, or using music. I've always been interested in music, not as a musician. I don't know how to play an instrument. I can't sing, don't read music. But since I think I was like 5 years old and my sister listens to 93KHJ, Golden, and the top 40 lists that were out every week at the local record store. And I think I was 6 when I stole $4 from my mom's purse to buy Creedence Clearwater Revival's album Green River. It's been not an obsession. I'm not obsessed, but I've always felt music is maybe, you know, maybe one of the most powerful art forms. I could make an argument for films, and that would be a really good argument. You know, I think that'd be a very nice argument to listen to. But I feel music is very powerful, and I wanted to start incorporating it into my work. And so this is a piece called MacArthur Park, and it's a self-portrait. It's sort of like an abstract landscape of myself lying down, green and yellow. Stomach, head, legs, the arms, there's another set of balls on the other side. And it's all attached to this really simple mechanism that, as it turns around, these kind of collapse down to the table, and then they kind of, because of course this is circular here, they go back up and wind up in position, and then go back down again. And then on top of the stomach area is a CD player. Nowadays it would just be an MP3 on some sort of device, but at that time a CD player with an amplifier, and it plays a trio of songs. Let's see. It starts with MacArthur Park. Which, do you guys know that song?
Spring was never waiting for us, dear. It ran one step ahead as we followed in the dance.
So this idea about loss, right? There's this cake written with this song, MacArthur Park. It's sitting in the park, and it's raining, and it melts.
MacArthur Park melting in the dark. Flowing down.
Someone left the cake out in the rain.
I don't think that he could take it. Cause it took so long to make it. And I'll never have that recipe again.
Finding your, getting your shit back together, taking the key away, getting your life, picking out the bad aspects of your life, coming back together. And then the third part, third song of the cycle, On Top of the World, Carpenter's version. So you have this kind of sense of loss, sense of gathering, and the sense of mindlessness.
Feelings coming over me. There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky, got the sun in my eyes. And
okay, see, there you go. So, so this is not only having using music, but bringing my voice into it, yet another aspect of performance, and something probably that I shouldn't have done. I mean, I'm glad I did. It's really a bad voice for singing, but I was also interested in the what's the opposite of ironic?
Sincere.
Thank you, Connor. The sincere gesture. I'm so sincere today. The sincere gesture. The fan. Like Amy Adler talks about that. She talks about her drawings, and she, you know, one of her happiest moments, at least it was fairly early in her career, maybe there's happier moments now, but was that one of the drawings she made of, I think it was River Phoenix, wound up in a Teen Beat magazine. Because she truly, the drawings weren't about this kind of removed gaze or something like that. They were about truly her interest in River Phoenix or in teen idolatry, you know, that so the singing is not, I'm not trying to be bad, I just am bad, but I'm still putting forward the effort. This kind of expanded into a piece called Music Machine, which was in Naples, took place in Naples, Italy. I was asked to work in this gallery called Theoretical Events and go and kind of hang out in Naples and figure out some artworks to make. And this was one of them, using a Vespa, which is very ubiquitous with that city, maybe more so than any other European city I've been into. It's just a sort of like the sound of these Vespas all the time, all over the place. But so I wanted to use to make kind of the lowrider version of that. So on it is this like a CD player, like a 200 watt amplifier, subwoofer, speakers on the back here, speakers on the windscreen, and that I rode around town with this playing, being the kind of the ugly cultural imperialist American. this is a Piazza Gesù Nuovo in Naples. the center of the old town, and playing songs such as... Where did it go? This is how it was made. This is the skull. Well, okay. What I wanted to do is I wanted this to make a two-part project. This is for Deitch project specifically. And he had a front gallery and then behind it a larger back gallery. And I wanted to have this video on a screen or projected in the front gallery so that there's this kind of fantasy element. There's this fantasy of this story of this girl walking on walls and ceiling and this interloper man in the room collapsing on him at the end. And then, but all the time in the back of the gallery was this large machine, which was the set for the video, but then it's this machine that is like grinding up all the bedroom. The bedroom is being ground up so that there's a sense of this fantasy and then the kind of the brutalness of what it is to kind of create fantasy. So I wanted this two-part thing. So I've shown it three times, once in Europe, once at Deitch, and once at the Orange County Museum last year, I guess it was, 08, I guess, February of 08. So if you don't mind, I'd like to show the documentary about putting up the tumble room piece, if you don't mind.
So it gets destroyed each time that...
Yeah, you know, yeah, the furniture, yeah.
Down on your knees and pray to me! There's something fascinating about slow motion destruction, controlled destruction.
Ha! Can you see me now?
This is the beginning of putting together Tumble Room, this massive machine of several tons of metal, wood, and stuffed animals. We have 12 of these. That's the beginning, isn't it? Oh, well, that's easy. What began as inspiration of watching Fred Astaire in Royal Wedding dance on the walls and dance on the ceilings. I took that inspiration and took it further to try to create an entropy machine, something that wore things down. And this, can I start again?
Sure.
And then, when you get a good speed going, then all of a sudden you just go. Tumble Room started as inspired by the film Royal Wedding. In the film, Fred Astaire, who is in love, dances on the walls and the ceilings. And I saw that and was mesmerized by that activity.
Ready? One, two, three.
I wondered, how was this done? Then I learned, so I kind of did a little research and found out, no, that doesn't sound, it all sounds so false. Maybe if I'm sitting. Well, the pink room, once a decision is made to make a spinning room, for all its various and sundry reasons of trying to make an entropy machine or like have a set that I can dance on the ceiling with, the type of room became the most important question. Whose room was it? My room? A storeroom? My dad's room? My mom's room? It became really important. And it came to me in a flash that if I was going to create that dynamic, that tension, that it would have to be a room that I didn't belong in. And whose room, as a 40-year-old male, don't I belong in? A teenage girl's room, unless she's my teenage daughter. But it's a room that I don't belong in. And it's a room that is also one filled with change, or the potential for change. Like the change from innocence, so to speak, to knowledge. Listen to that sound, nice, isn't it? It kind of sounds like a ship, a wooden ship. It's Miley. I'm gonna replace Jennifer Love Hewitt with Miley Cyrus. You know, here's what we're gonna do. See, this is Jennifer Love Hewitt. To be like, but in reality, I'm more of the Buster Keaton, which is uneasy in his way and never quite on top of the game. Though of course, if you answer, that's me. That's the kind of representation I'm always after with my own, with the representation of myself.
Thank you.
Wanted to be a sculpture that tore things apart.
And that's going to go against the door, next to the door, like that.
Its structure or its mechanics is somewhat based upon the idea of a rock tumbler, but instead of rocks being worn down to shiny gems, this turns in things from the girls' room, a bed, a chest of drawers, magazines, stuffed animals.
Yeah, I think we need to have Miley Blakey.
And it takes these things whole and turns them into various component parts of detritus. Things that fluff and things that fall apart and things that become not, well, unidentifiable.
And this is a snagging pop star. It's really good. Anyone want to look at it before I toss it in?
Pop star.
So Kirby, these are flowers, fresh flowers. I think put them on the bedside table. I guess that's it. thank Peter West for making the video. This may be a good time to talk about something that I think is interesting to talk about at art schools, and that's about production, about one's own practice and how one decides how what one is going to make and how they're going to do that. And because I went to school at as a grad school at UCLA at a time when, let's see, we had a lot of faculty who were making big things, like Charlie Ray. There. He had done the, I think when I was in grad school, he made the fire truck for the Whitney Biennial. Paul McCarthy, of course, who's made all sorts of like large installations. He, you know, I think, you know, at this time even more so. Chris Burden, who was making Medusa's head, Mecano sculptures, things like that. There was Larry Pittman, who I remember him talking about one. When he was in the when Documenta, he said, "Well, I'm making these jumbo paintings because I have to keep up with the other guys." That there was this sense of production beyond the scope of ordinary means, so to speak, or obviously ordinary means. And so, in my production, for the most part, I was always sort of in control of it. It was always I had people maybe work on things. I didn't print my own photographs. I maybe didn't understand electronics always. I had people who would assist me. My wife takes my photographs. So it's not like a solitary sense of practice. But it was one where I was very hands-on and involved. And when Jeffrey asked me, you know, is there anything I've always wanted to do, I had told him this. I told him I wanted to make this a video in a tumble room. And it's changed. Like, and it was sort of like, oh yeah, now I can be like my teachers, right? Like Jeffrey's gonna give me that idea that I can be like my teachers. And it was what I expected, and it also wasn't what I wanted, really. In the long run of things, because what occurred was like the tumble room was you know had to find a fabricator, and so we go out and get bids on how things are made, because we're not talking inconsiderable amounts of money, you have to like get the bid, and you have to talk to people, and you have to see how it's going to be made, and you have to figure it out, and then like when you work with a crew, like I had to hire a crew to shoot this, and it was this whole, and then there was this photo shoot that went along with it, and then there was like taking it apart, and then there was resetting it, and there was this whole like miasma of like extraneous stuff that made, kind of pulled me away, or I felt pulled me away from like what interested me in the studio practice, which was being involved intimately with some process or material in order to make something that I found intriguing. And this was sort of like about the opposite. This was about sort of like hands off in a lot of ways. And I'm by no means ruining the day that I got to do this project, because I do feel it turned out to what I wanted it to be, luckily, because I think it could have gone astray in so many different ways. But it made me rethink about what I wanted from the art world, and what I should say, not from the art world, but from what from the art, my art practice. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Explaining, mm-hmm. Like, and it sort of was this point. It's like this gut check, right? This gut check of like, what is it? Like, you know, what is? Why am I doing this? Because, and I think we're all sort of having this gut check now in a certain way right now, because, the parameters and the rules have all changed again. And they shift periodically, they shift greatly, and we're in the middle of such a shift. And what is it that we want? Like, is it that we're searching out to make big things and become famous? Or are we like people like who are are you idiosyncratic and just looking to some way to fulfill some sort of itch that you can't scratch in any other way? And I think it's just this was the time for me to kind of reassess that. And I think, I guess I'm saying right now is another time to kind of reassess that. So, so at the same time, it didn't mean like changing the practice didn't mean necessarily changing, making smaller work only or something like that. But it was about kind of finding ways to make work. And the first chance I kind of got to do that again was a couple of years later. So this was, I showed Tumble Room in February of 2001. And I had a chance to work at the Mass MoCA. I don't know if you know this museum. It's in North Adams, Massachusetts, which was a small little town that had a semiconductor factory and a fabric factory, dyeing factory before that. You know, one of those northeastern towns which had us built around an industry. When the semiconductor factory went away, like the whole town went into sort of depression. And 17 years later, a museum was born out of that. A huge museum in terms of space, but not in terms of budget. Like, it wasn't like the Guggenheim or something like that. It was just this kind of modern museum where they invited artists to do projects. And what they offered was their expertise in making things. They had a crew that was really good. So I had a chance to go and work for a couple of weeks to make a work for a show that was, I think it was about 10 to 12 artists who were interacting or reacting to this collection called the Society for the Preservation of New England Antiquities, one of these old-timey organizations that has like 70,000 objects of old New England in this storehouse, and also like, I think it's like 23 or 24 different properties from like Mies van der Rohe's personal residence to colonial farmhouses. And so we were again, like the Getty Project, able to kind of go down an avenue exploration that we were interested in, and they gave us carte blanche to that. And so I thought I'd be interested in the objects that they had in their collection, but what I wound up being interested in was this house called Beauport in Massachusetts I forget now the name of the town. It's an old whaling village. And Henry Davis Sleeper was a designer slash architect who bought this, like in the late 20s, early 30s, bought this 4 or 5 room farmhouse and converted it into like a 45 room kind of mansion. Not quite as weird as say Winchester Mystery House. But in that way, like there's certain parts you couldn't get to unless you went through the whole bottom floor and went up to that way. It had a traditional colonial kitchen in it. But what was interesting was that Sleeper himself had this interest in America. So the things weren't like, William Randolph Hearst loved Europe. Sleeper loved America, and he loved the history of America. But he didn't like it as a historian would in terms of this kind of organizational chart or this way of kind of creating, curating in this way of by time period. He was curating just in this by type. So there's this room that's about George Washington, a lot of George Washington. But there'll be a very beautiful bust, but there also will be a bust of George Washington that was a maple syrup bottle, or there'll be other things. So he was mixing all these different kind of cultures, high and low. And that was really interesting to me. That. So, and the second part was that this house was built on rock, and they had all these problems with drainage and different kinds of bugs, and the organization was always trying to stop it from falling into the sea, so to speak, decrepitude. And their job was to stop entropy, and I was interested in that, is their charge of stopping entropy. So I kind of worked with this crew to make this kind of fairy tale boot that kind of encompassed sort of elements of fantasy, but also about mythologies. So here at the toe of the boot, which is like a greenhouse, that has that has like remnants of furniture and mulch and sort of like this kind of bed, a fecund bed of that out of this crows a cherry tree, which is actually a George Washington myth, right? The George Washington myth of chopping down the cherry tree. But then inside the heel of the boot back here is like a chandelier hanging from and wallpaper of the period, but also like pot plants or hemp plants, because at the same time, like, you know, the other kind of, I don't know if it's a myth, but the history of our country of it being built, you know, Washington and Jefferson wanting a kind of an agrarian economy, while like someone like Madison wanted sort of more like an early industrial, colonial industrial kind of economy. And so hemp was supposed to be a way towards our, you know, our future, our greatness as a country. And so these kind of these mixing of myths and these kind of these makings of a story and kind of merging all into this boot and kind of conservation and entropy, like all kind of mixing. And what I found was that working with the crew on this, like working with designs and actually being there, I started to see like that's kind of, I can make big projects, but I kind of have to, I can't just sort of, I don't feel, I can't just farm them out. So, I'm sorry, we're kind of getting close. I want some questions too. So. So that was like from 2003 or four, two, no, 2003, I think. And in 2005, I asked again to work on a project for another show, this one called Dionysiac, which was the curator at the Pompidou was interested in a Dionysian versus the Apollonian kind of attitudes towards the ideal of beauty. And so the, you know, she kind of framed it as, well, the Dionysian's like punk rock and shit, you know, like that's how, like kind of, she was like kind of looking at it. And so to that end, it became this weird show of like, not boys, like Joseph Boys, but B-O-Y-S, like the bad boys, Paul McCarthy and Jason Rhodes and Thomas Hirshhorn and Maurizio Catalan and, you know, anyway, and making all these kind of like, quote, bad boy kind of things. And I was asked, and I never thought of myself as a bad boy, but what I was interested in was ideas of consistency and safety in a way. And so I made a nest that is made up of objects, well, made of willow, basically, but made of objects of the household. And if you don't mind, I can show you another, just a, I should have opened this earlier. So this is about 14 feet across the top and about 9 feet tall, and it turns at this speed. This is it at the Pompidou. And so there's this nest, which is a symbol of like safety a lot of times, or you know, birth. And it's made up of things of our household. So I wanted with that to try to create this sense of instability within it. Something that was both relatable and, oh, it's a nest, oh, and then it's like, well, what kind of thing made this nest of a crib and a clock and like all these different objects that I have gathered. Some from my house, some from friends' houses, and some just flea markets and things like that, which is, I was going to, let's quit that. just sort of like my son's old slippers and a dog collar from a dog that had died, or his maracas that someone had given us, various pieces of clothing, felt, you know, jewelry, pottery, broken things. Like, so it was just like chock full. There's like, you know, a huge amount of things that are all kind of itemized for this nest that go back into it in various places. Gonna skip over that. So I'm gonna skip over a lot.
Martin, was the Loud House piece the first time you'd worked with that scale? Because it seems like a recurring scale for you.
Yeah. I don't think I have, I don't know if I have an image of that. I actually don't have an image of Loud House. Michael refers to it was like sort of like a metal shed, like 14, 15 feet deep, 12 feet wide, and about 12 feet tall, with a monitor on it. And the monitor has an image of myself dancing with clogs, or clog dancing. And the walls are all made of metal, but there's like these 8 really heavy-duty speaker drivers on the inside. So every time I step on the wood, it causes the whole house to kind of shake and rumble. And that was the first piece I undertook that was sort of larger than my body. Right? I guess that's sort of how I think of things. There's small things that you use. There's things my body size that are a little awkward, and then there's things that are bigger than my body.
Well, they seem like big pieces until you're in them or something.
Then they seem tiny. Yeah. It's like a tricycle. I want to talk a little bit about this kind of, I have like so little time left. I want to talk about performance, because that's where I start, like with like actual performance, but that's where I'm interested in still. And I guess maybe...
Can you talk a little bit about rickety?
Yeah, I think that's what I was going to do. This was in 07, I opened a show at the Tang Museum in Saratoga Springs at Skidmore College. And it's a survey show that then also came to Santa Monica. But at the time, the curator, when we started organizing the show, we went through a list of all the different kind of works we wanted. And the proposal I had was that we kind of both came to it, that this show would be about action and activity. And so that all the photos were going to be all the photos of action, and weren't going to be any ones that weren't. The pieces were all going to be move or have a great sense of implied movement in them. And to that end, I was interested in not making a museum show per se that was going to be kill the work. I'm not saying all museum shows kill the work, but I was very inspired from a show in the 80s that Borofsky did at the TC here. Did anyone see that? Wasn't that great?
Yeah, it was awesome. And each venue had a different game.
Yeah,
like play basketball here, and then you play ping pong and go with me.
Oh, really? Yeah, it had a basketball court in there, and I thought then people would, you can play, or that the installation crew would take their lunch hour and play some basketball. So I like that sense of the space had been enlivened in some way, you know, and not be kind of this dead, sterile space that was just, you know, there to make a history. And so. One was to remove all the interior walls, so there were no walls in the space. And the second move was to like hang the photos. I don't know if there's a better shot. Yeah, to hang all the photos, kind of salon style, coming out of a corner. So this wall, like that ceiling in the far corner, is like 50 feet up. So those other photos are like 18 feet up. The tallest of the photos in the corner, maybe like 14 to 18 feet up. So there's this wall of photos kind of looking down at you, as opposed to kind of these discrete elements. But they have this definite, like, you know, like place in there. But the biggest element, and was like a little hard to convince Ian, was to have the largest piece be the newest work, one that hadn't been created, and also that was going to act as a performance venue for other events in the gallery itself. So I worked loosely with a choreographer who was actually in a lot of the photos, Melinda Ring, who I've known since junior high school, middle school. And she and I were talking, she was going to create a dance and I was going to create a place for this dance to occur. And I came upon this idea of creating, a space that's 14, 18 feet and 4 feet tall. So it's 14 wide, 14 deep, 4 feet tall, where the whole dance would either take place on top or on the bottom. And so the dance would move, would shift around these holes that are around these fake trees. So you go up and down these spaces and never really leave the perimeter of the sculpture. So it stays within the sculpture, but the sculpture becomes this stage and this performance space for this dance, specifically for it. So that worked really well. It was for 5 dancers. And then when we moved it to Santa Monica, she brought the dance out with a group of 3 dancers. And it was at the end. But that being in the hometown allowed other things to happen. Like we had, I did my artist lecture from that space. I had a performance class come in and do performances on that. So Leonard Nimoy did a lecture on it about something or other at one time. So we had a book club meeting on it. So all these different things that it turned the museum space, which I'm not saying is a dead space. I have nothing against museums at all. But I wanted to be a museum, I guess, on my terms, or terms that I was interested in. And that was sort of the space of activity. And that's something that I'm, you know, interested in. Again, like I said, it starts with performance. And I really try to bring it back into the practice later. This is a sculpture from last year called Headache. And it's a kind of this hybrid of a drum pedal and a sinking ship, or a sinking ship drum pedal. I just finished a show in Italy, and it's the idea for the show in Italy was called Fat Iggy. Came from these photos, and again, I've been reading a lot about punk rock music, early British, but also in America, Cleveland, New York, even and a little bit, somewhat in LA. But I was interested in the figure of Iggy Pop as someone who did kind of probably the most damage any single person could do to their body, maybe, with behavior, drugs, drinking, driving, whatever, sex. It's totally an amazing character. But I wanted to create kind of the more, the Iggy that took it maybe more cautiously somehow, and instead of aged and got fat and try to do the things that they used to do in their heyday. So these are all I love the big butt. That's a big ass, isn't it? It's with aluminum tape on the pants. It's really good. And so I wanted to kind of extend that a little bit, and I've never really tried that, but I've never really created a character. I've always used, it's been me as me. And so this creation of Fat Iggy kind of led to these drawings I did I think it was the series called Never Was album mock-ups. So these are all, the squares are all, they're all square like album or CD covers, all various sizes. They're all kind of reduced, but they're mock-ups. So these were albums that Fat Iggy made. So the only U part is would have been by the graphic designer put in up at the top or something. So I'm just sort of trying to sketch in Fat Iggy's albums would have been, sort of punk. So they both have that ironic sense of using Richard Nixon, and the title would be Shine On, or you'd have Elvis and Richard Nixon in a duets album or something, but at the same time, Fat Iggy is also it is the course of the artist, that you go from doing your most raucous work to then making a duets album with some country star, or the greatest hits album, or the live album or something, right? or, you know, like, bring me your fat, this is Felmstarke, fat of you. Felmstarke is like force field, you know, like, kind of different kind of attitudes of like the career trajectory of like a long-lasting, like, rock person, you know, like, I'm sorry, the photos are kind of bad because I just took them with my camera recently. I mean, this is just up right now. Bad Man Ballads, you know, this is Andreas Botter. You know, so there's the kind of the punk ethos, you know, you use like a badass terrorist for your album cover, you know. Give him a hand, like that's Mao, Fatty Live, you know, like, so I really loved the idea of work on paper a lot. Because I think it really shows a different thought process than, say, sculpture or painting or finished work. But I never really found the right form for me, and I'm really enthused about making album covers. So this was, you know, like Last Call, like a little girl with empty bottles, you know, so idiotic, so idiotic that I feel. And then I set them this is the gallery in Torino, that you have, like, I set them up sort of like the photo wall, like just sort of, you know, as opposed to these discrete objects, they kind of like have this more power as this grouping. And this gallery is unlike any other gallery I've worked with. It's called Guido Costa Projects, and it used to be, I forget what it was, it wasn't a garage, but it was some sort of industrial space, small industrial space. And he didn't have enough money to redo the walls when he started, and then he showed who's the German artist who uses his family's home as the basis for all his work. He won the Young Lion Award like 6 years ago.
Steiger.
What's that?
Like Steiger.
Something like that. He did.
He did a piece over here. Right?
Yeah, he did. But the first show was a work back, so it was sort of like it made sense in this gallery, and then he just decided to keep the gallery walls as it is, and it's been now like, you know, 70 shows, and the gallery walls are just sort of, oh, there's the new Cinquecento, in case those of you who follow Italian cars. The Cinquecento is the Fiat 500, and it was sort of like kind of Italy's answer to the Volkswagen, or to Italy's answer to the Mini Cooper, the Cooper. And it's a real tiny car, and they stopped it, and now they've redone it, and this is how it looks. Anyway, I just took a picture. So the space that I use the space in is I decided to have a show in one part of it where I had the photos, some sculpture, and then create a performance space in the other part of the gallery and create a little stage. And this was the act's performance, which you saw in the video we created there. And the space, if you look back, you see the sculpture in the back, that's the other space, and then this is the view from when you enter the show. So there's the drawings in the corner, these photographs, there's some sculpture, and then when you would turn the corner, you'd get, you get to the performance space. And so there was, for the opening, there was a performance, and then also for throughout the show, I think maybe every third Thursday, there'll be some sort of event, like they have two philosophers who will do a debate, there'll be a contortionist, there'll be a children's puppet show, or something like that. So that, again, it changes the dynamic of the gallery space into one. And I'm not trying to make a public community center, because I think, but it is it's more like of a gathering space in order to kind of create a relationship with the sculpture and the art on the walls. I just thought that looked like a David Lynch set, sort of. Didn't it, with those red curtains? That's Ferrari red too, by the way. It came like Italy is what's really great about Italy. Well, it's just a very soulful place, I think. But that they got the curtains from the Ferrari auto show. They got them really cheap, so they're literally from the Ferrari booth. That's it. That's my lecture. I'm here for questions now. People have them. I know that it ends kind of odd. Lecture. I have to work on that. I'm sorry about that. But I didn't talk about certain, the new sculptures and everything, but you can ask questions.
I just out of curiosity, what's that sweater one on the red thing?
This thing?
Yeah.
Okay, that's a pair of my pants with mirror tiles. It's like, I call it grotto. So the mirror tiles go all the way down, so you kind of look to the bottom of the pants, and then every 5 minutes, hold on, this plays. So when you're in the show, that all of a sudden underneath the box, there's this like a really powerful speaker. All of a sudden, that will just go off every 5 minutes, and it will vibrate the glass, which then like causes the ceiling, all the reflection in the ceiling, to kind of vibrate. And so it's this sort of the performance is brought into the sphere, the sculpture. I didn't want something that would chase people away. I wanted something that would be attract people, and also frighten them a little bit too, because it just goes on. That's the end of Search and Destroy by Iggy Pop, and I just sort of looped it, added the final guitar. I kind of repeated those and just kind of made it so it was like bass heavy, and so it really kind of like really shaped things up.
Can you talk a little bit about the stool piece where you hacked the stool? Because I thought that was sort of interesting when you were talking about doing large scale productions, and you also talked about the transition from doing your work with the Shrimps, mm-hmm. where you were doing kind of more direct performance with an audience, to work where the final presentation was documentation. And I found it really fascinating that you combined this very sort of simple but sort of complex and sort of funny and dark piece, which is you sort of doing the seductive dance and then hacking the stool that was like your pedestal for your body, and then this sort of large scale thing with the tumble room. And you know, what was that piece about, and why did you combine the two?
One is happenstance. Like, is that the museum goes, oh, you didn't do performance, but can you do that for the opening? It's like, I don't know what I'm gonna do. And then I thought, oh, I could hack this thing, and then I could like throw it all in there, because it's like part of the girls' room. Like, it's sort of like, because in the video, the room falls apart on me. Like, I don't know if you, like, in the video, the room, she's on the ceiling, so basically, you know, all that stuff is upside down. It's all in place, it's all perfect, it all stays in place as she goes around, and even when I'm in there. But at the very end, I sit on that bed, and then the room all comes at me and chases me around the room. I loosen everything, right? Everything is screwed down.
Was that in that, were you in there in the video?
Yeah.
Oh.
So it's chasing me around. So it's sort of like it is destructive impulse, or its worst impulse, is trying to destroy me at the same time. So I just sort of extended outside of the tumble room, so to speak, to have myself do this performance that I thought was kind of about, because I'm the goofball in the video. She's the one who seems to be the most thoughtful, has introspection, has joy. I'm the one who's always like somehow fucking up. I'm getting like I'm falling down, I'm tripping over stuff, the room eventually destroys me in a way. And so I thought it was, I thought that gesture of doing the live performance as a sort of, almost like as a way when they bust the champagne bottle on the bow of a ship, right? Because to put together that, you know, to bring that piece out and to have the wherewithal, you know, it took not that many people, but it's like a commitment to for a museum or anyone to put together a piece. And I felt like we spend like a week on it and we put it together and we do the whole thing. Okay, and this was sort of like a christening in a way. It was more or less about practice than it was sort of about kind of the event. And also I think when they asked me to perform, I didn't want to create a performance because, but I thought it would be nice to have a performance for it and to bring that kind of energy, that live, because there's nothing like a live body, something, you know, in a space doing something. You know, it's very singular. Did that answer?
Yeah, I wasn't even like looking for a particular answer, but I just think it was such a interesting combination of those two things within the video and, you know, how interesting it is to use a, you know, this sort of one prop and how, you know, you started out with this kind of, you know, seductive dance, which to me sort of went back to the film piece that you did. I mean, this was sort of in a live setting.
Yeah.
And then it very quickly took this dark turn where you're, you know, kind of bringing yourself down, essentially.
Yeah.
Well, sadistic and masochistic at the same time.
My Italian gallerist said, like Guido Costa, he said, well, it just shows you're trying to emasculate yourself. Freud would say, and he's like, no, it's not me saying it, it's Freud. About, because the stool was in the performance and it was three-legged.
Right,
and I
right.
said I was the middle child. He said, oh, you are trying to become like your sisters. You are the middle child, and you feel the pressure from both sides. So, but it is not me saying it, it is Freud. So, I don't know.
Martin, I was fortunate enough to stumble upon your mini retrospective at the time at the Santa Barbara Museum years ago.
Uh-huh.
And
98 or 97.
Yeah, and there was I've always held that show in my mind as being like that was like an incredible show in itself, but it was a very particular body of work where I felt like there was, you kind of limited the decision making in the materials. Like there was the pieces were much more conceptually driven, and you know, like where you had these experiments, and then the materials were almost kind of like I felt like you had a palette in terms of the colors. But they were still very limited by like, okay, I need a temperature gauge and an extension
and
cord
an amplifier,
and you compose them beautifully, and then I've noticed like now with the newer work, there's been a continual shift from that kind of like lack of material-based, material savvy. The new work is more. The subject seems like the materiality has become more of a subject of the work, whereas before it was like kind of secondary to the
process,
to the concept. Yeah, to the
kind
of
process
ideas.
Of usage. Well, yeah, I think that is.
Is that it? Yeah, I don't know.
Well, I mean, yes and no. I mean, people always felt like, oh, you're the guy that uses the motors and the colored power cords. That's what some people had said, too, because that was sort of like how I would go, oh, here's a blue power cord, I'll use that. Okay, here's an amplifier, I'll use that. Like, my palette was more limited, like, because the operations were more limited. It was more of that beginning exploration of trying to make something perform. And I think that was where I was more interested in, and however I made it, whatever materials I gathered were less important, but I don't want to diminish it because I did look for specific kind of things, like a specific kind of amplifier, right? Like that it's going to be big enough to do the job, but not too big that it becomes the centerpiece of the work. So there was always a balance, but I think what's happened is that I've become a better builder of things, and that I've branched out and stretched in trying different kind of things that I would never have done before. Like, and this is like this is wire work. Like I never would have considered wire work back then. This is the Death Star lamp. And it's about this big, right? But it's like it's based on Swedish tramp art, right? Or tramp art here, Swedish wire work, kind of this melding of kind of craft. Like I started getting interested in handcraft, not in a folky way, right? Like
yeah,
so.
Yeah.
So it started, the work started to take on a different look. And I think it's been an issue with my practice is that I don't make a signature type of piece anymore. Like I think those early works, people were really enthused because they could kind of see that they all had a certain similar look. And now they're all over the fuck the place, really. You know, there's no, you know. But that's what's interesting to me as an artist is to be able to do that, right? You know, and you know, I don't know. Again, wire work, funny work. Now this looks like this reminds me of older work somehow. I don't know. But anyway, that's just me.
I don't want to do this, but we're there time-wise, and that's why we're going to lunch. So you can get more Martin at La Chiquiza, but we've got to wrap it up because of classes and such. So Martin, I want to thank you so much. It was awesome.